Niacin is a well-known drug that is used in the management of dyslipidemia. It's a lipid-modifying agent with a broad-spectrum effect. Niacin reduces very low-density lipoproteins level in the blood, triglyceride level, and low-density lipoproteins level. But the side effect of niacin is flushing of the face and of the upper body. And in fact, flushing is a major reason for the discontinuation of therapy, so it's a very disturbing side effect. Initially, niacin was used only as vitamin in treatment of pellagra, but after niacin lipid-modifying features were discovered, niacin activates the specific receptor called HCA2 receptor, which stands for hydroxycarboxylic acid receptor 2. This receptor, also called G-protein-coupled receptor 109A, and in mice, this receptor called PUMA-G. So basically, there are a lot of different names, but the same receptor. HCA2 receptor is expressed on a number of cells in different tissues, including fat tissue, where this receptor is present on adipocytes, but also this receptor is present on Langerhans cells and keratinocytes in epidermis. Recall that epidermis consists of mainly of keratinocytes that are arranged in stratified squamous epithelium, and also epidermis has its own macrophages that are called Langerhans cells. Langerhans cells is a specialized epidermal dendritic cells that make approximately 2-4% of total amount of cells in epidermis. They function as antigen presenting cells. Basically, when they come in contact with the antigen, they uptake antigen, and with this antigen they migrate from the epidermal compartment to the draining lymph node, where they present some fragments of antigen to the effector cells of adaptive immune system. So, first of all, about niacin lipid-modifying effect. To explain this, we have to know normal physiology. To mobilize fatty acids from their cellular lipid stores, and fatty acids are stored in form of triacylglycerols in lipid droplets, most cells in human body, particularly adipocytes, have specific enzyme called hormone-sensitive lipase. It hydrolyzes stored triacylglycerols into diacylglycerols and free fatty acids. The activity of hormone-sensitive lipase is controlled by protein kinase A. The concept is that hormone-sensitive lipase is activated only in phosphorylated state. Basically, phosphorylation induces conformational changes in this enzyme that increase exposed surface area between hormone-sensitive lipase and triacylglycerol droplet, and by this it facilitates binding of an enzyme to its substrate. So by this it markedly increases the speed of hydrolyzation. And phosphorylation is provided by protein kinase A. Protein kinase A called cyclic AMP-dependent kinase because the activity of this enzyme depends on concentrations of cyclic AMP molecules in the cytosol. And cyclic AMP molecules are produced by adenylate cyclase that converts ATP molecule into cyclic AMP. And when niacin binds to HCA2 receptor on adipocytes, it triggers activation of the receptor-associated G-inhibitory G-protein that inhibits the activity of adenylate cyclase. With decreasing cyclic AMP, the activity of protein kinase A decreases, thereby phosphorylation of hormone-sensitive lipase decreases. And in unphosphorylated state, the activity of hormone-sensitive lipase is very low. So the rate of hydrolyzation decreases and thereby the release of free fatty acids into the circulation decreases. And basically, it's the mechanism of niacin antilipidemic activity. But the problem is that Langerhans cells and keratinocytes in the epidermis also have HCA2 receptors, and when niacin binds to them, in this case, activation of HCA2 receptor causes increase in activity of phospholipase C that results in increase in intracellular calcium level. Recall that the mechanism is that phospholipase C catalyzes the hydrolysis of the phosphatidyl inositol biphosphate with formation of two end products, inositol triphosphate and diacylglycerol. Inositol triphosphate then diffuses through the cytoplasm and interacts with inositol triphosphate receptors on endoplasmic reticulum, and this results in release of calcium from endoplasmic reticulum, thereby rising the level of intracellular calcium. Increasing intracellular calcium stimulates activity of phospholipase A2 that releases arachidonic acid. It takes arachidonic acid from the phospholipids in the cellular membrane. And arachidonic acid is a substrate for cyclooxygenase. We know that there are two forms of cyclooxygenase, it's COX-1 and COX-2. And the main difference between Langerhans cells and keratinocytes exactly in COX enzyme. Most cells in human body, including Langerhans cells, constitutively, this means most of the time, express COX-1 enzyme, and the activity of COX-2 enzyme is highly restricted. But keratinocytes are among these few cells that constitutively express COX-2 enzyme. COX enzyme from arachidonic acid is capable to form various types of prostaglandins. But in terms of our discussion, COX-1 enzyme in Langerhans cells form prostaglandin D2 and prostaglandin E2, and COX-2 enzyme in keratinocytes form prostaglandin E2. Then these prostaglandins from epidermis cross the dermis and act on their receptors that are localized on smooth muscle cells of the dermal blood vessels. Prostaglandin D2 acts on DP1 receptor, and prostaglandin E2 acts on EP receptor type 2 and type 4. From biochemistry, we know that the effects of prostaglandins depends on the tissue expression of the receptor and on type of G protein to which this receptor is coupled. And generally, all prostaglandin receptors are divided into two major groups according to their effects on smooth muscle cells, on relaxant and excitatory. As we see, both DP1 receptor and EP2 and 4 receptors are relaxant receptors that induce vasodilation of smooth muscle cells of dermal blood vessels. The mechanism of relaxation is that once these prostaglandins act on their receptors on smooth muscle cells, it induces activation of adenylate cyclase that converts ATP into cyclic AMP, and the increase in cyclic AMP induces relaxation of smooth muscle cells. Obviously, this results in vasodilation, and vasodilation manifests this flash of hyperemia. But also important that COX-1 enzyme in Langerhans cells becomes activated first. And because of that, initially, in response to niacin, Langerhans cells react first. They very rapidly produce large amount of prostaglandins, primarily of prostaglandin D2. That immediately cause flash of hyperemia, but this effect is short-lived and called the minor hyperemia peak. And only then COX-2 enzyme in keratinocytes becomes fully activated and produces large amount of prostaglandin E2 that causes this prolonged hyperemia that called the major hyperemia peak. Prostaglandin D2 is the major prostaglandin that is released after injection of niacin. Also interesting that prostaglandin D2 levels in the venous blood and dermal blood vessels are substantially higher than the levels in the arterial blood. So we see that Langerhans cells become activated very rapidly, and they generate tremendous amount of prostaglandin D2, but they remain activated for a very short period of time. In contrast to them, keratinocytes activation is delayed, but they remain in activated state for a prolonged period of time. The onset of flushing is typically within 20 minutes to 1 hour after niacin intake, and the duration is generally 1 hour. The skin flush typically starts in the face with a deep red coloration, usually accompanied by intense feeling of warmth and itching. Occasionally, flushing extends to the arms and chest. Also, a natural tolerance for flushing occurs with tachyphylaxis to prostaglandin D2 secretion that usually develops after 1 week of therapy. But we can eliminate and prevent flushing by three major ways. By controlling the absorption rate of niacin, for this purpose, extended-release niacin was developed that prolonged absorption time and provides more moderate niacin absorption. By preventing the production of prostaglandins, we have aspirin and other related non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs that inhibit both isoforms of COX enzyme and thereby they prevent vasodilation and eliminate flushing. And by blocking of prostaglandin receptors. For this purpose, we have lorapiprant that blocks DP1 receptor and thereby substantially reduce flushing.